Take a hymn book, 572 in your hymnal. 572 if you need that words there. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Let's sing that first and last of sing praises to the Lord this morning. Blessed. Love 348. 348, my Savior's love. I stand amazed in the presence. Sing it out on that first hymn number 348.
I'm so glad that that is true. He is so wonderful, isn't he? Thank for the Lord Jesus Christ who loves us so much. I love that verse, don't you? It's so familiar, John 3:16, but don't you love it? Say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God is so good to us. Good to see you in God's house today. Heavenly Father, give us a wonderful service today. We look forward to lifting up your name, lifting up your word. We do ask that everything we say and do would bring honor and glory to thee. You're a great God and a mighty God. And we're thankful for this great truth that we sang, that when we know your Son is our personal Savior, there is blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he has saved us. Thank you for your mercy and grace. And thank you for your Son who loves us so much and how you love us so much. We ask now that you'll bless and use this service once again. May our hearts be ready to receive your word. May everything we say and do and think bring honor and glory to your precious Son. For we ask it in his name. Amen. If you're visiting today, we welcome you to Arlington. We're glad that you're here. The ushers are coming down the aisle, and they would like to give all of our guests and visitors something today. And we're glad that you're here with us. Always a privilege to have guests and visitors. So if you're visiting today, just put your hand up wherever you're at, and our ushers will see you and bring you and give you something today. So if you're visiting today, make sure that you get that. Keep it up just a moment. They will see you and hand that to you. And it's our privilege to have you here. When you sit down in just a moment, if you'll do me a great privilege and just fill that card out, drop it in the offering plate so that we get to know you a little bit better also, and then keep everything else as a reminder of your visit here. But got everybody covered? Wonderful. So good to see each one of you today. And here we are, June. School's about ready to finish. Man, a lot of exciting things going on. Summer's right upon us. But it's good to be in God's house. All right, we'll let you be seated, and we'll hear from the choir.
This rock, we have a firm foundation, church, in Christ and in the Word of God. Would you stand as we sing about that this morning? 184 in your hymn book. 184. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. 184 in your hymn book.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
This morning. Find someone nearby and just let them know you're glad to see them at church this morning. Find your way back to your seat. Grab a hymn book there. 184. Hymn number 184. If you need the words there, we'll sing that chorus and that second verse. Thy word is lamp unto my feet. 184. Let's sing it out. Starting off with that chorus together, church. Church, you may be seated.
All right, in just a moment we'll receive the offering, but I want to remind you of a few things. Don't forget, tonight we'll have our service at 6 o'clock, like you normally do down at the chapel. Tonight I'll bring a new series of messages I'll do through the summertime called Portraits of a Christian, and I put some things in the bulletin about that. I've been talking about it. The world is trying to define on their terms what a Christian is. Well, I think we ought to get to see what God has to say that a Christian is. And God, in His Word, gives us portraits of that, of what it looks like. So we'll be right out of the Bible. So tonight at 6 o'clock, we'll do that. And tonight, we'll have the first one of that. So you'll be with us tonight also. Notice, and there's also inside your bulletin, there is a handout in there of our summer Sunday night fellowships. They begin in just a couple of weeks on June the 16th, and you'll find that. So you kind of know what's going on for the summertime, and this is a time we have just getting together after the evening service. Everybody's invited that comes and be with us, and just something to eat after the service. Now, this is not a menu, just so you understand. You look at it and say, well, I'll come on that week. I like ice cream. I won't come that week. I don't like this. Nah, come for every one of them. And so you'll get spiritual food beforehand and physical food afterward. What a blessing it is. So remember about that. Begins in a couple weeks. Just wanted you to know about that. Then also, let me remind our teenagers and also the parents of our teenagers, don't forget about getting involved for the summer trip that they're doing. FaithWorks is going out to the Joshua camp out in July. You see that information in the bulletin. But make sure, parents, I would surely encourage you to get behind the young people and encourage them to go. It would be a wonderful time there and life-changing things that can happen as a result of it. Next Sunday, after the after we do observe the Lord's Supper, the offering that we take for that, normally is for needy families. I want to take that to kind of help the expenses of some of our teenagers going to camp. So we'll do that after the service next Sunday. But I want you to pray about it. I want you to be encouraging to our teenagers. And I think we can do so much we can to invest in the next generation. And this will help us with that. So remind you about that. Of course, Summer Blast that we have, our program through our school that will be open, running through the summer, begins June 17th. And make sure you see that. And if you have some children like be involved in that, you can get the information from the school office. And then a couple other things I want to make mention to you. Vacation Bible School begins June 19th, just a couple of weeks from this Wednesday, runs all through the summertime. And so make sure you start inviting others to come, tell them all about it. June 19th through August the 7th, and on Wednesday night. And so 6:30 each one of those nights. Great time for the children and of their Vacation Bible School every Wednesday night through the summertime. And then the last one I give you, next Sunday evening, each Sunday evening in July, my wife will be doing a class called Summer of Signs. And maybe some of you want to learn a little bit of sign language and be able to communicate with those in our deaf ministry. And so just kind of a helpful time with that. You can see the announcement in the bulletin coming up. You can sign up for that course. It doesn't even cost you anything. And the teacher is extraordinary. Amazing. She's taught me things for years. And some of it's sign language, too. And we even have our own sign language that works very well. Anyways, I'll get off that. But that is coming up in the month of July. You can see that in the bulletin. I hope you'll do that. It'll be Sunday evenings before the service. You can come to there, go to the service, have the fellowship time afterward. So a lot of things coming up. Make sure that you get a bulletin, tells you all about that. It's good to see each one of you today. Guys, if you'll come, let's receive the offering now. And we're grateful that we can be faithful in our tithes and offerings. And God has been very good to us. And we want to be faithful always to Him. And thank you for being a church that does that and stands behind this and the work we do, reaching with our missions and everything else all over the world. Let's ask the Lord to bless as we give. Brother Whitehead, would you come pray for us if you would?
Thank you, Lord. Father God, in the name of Jesus, as we come before you today to give this offering, Lord God, we just thank and praise you, Lord, for being the sacrifice for us, for shedding your blood on Calvary that we might be redeemed from the pit of hell. In Jesus' precious name, we ask, oh God, that you will bless this offering today. We pray that it will be used for the furtherance of your kingdom. We give you all the praise, honor, and glory as we ask these things in your name. Amen and amen. Thank you.
scripture reading this morning is in the book of Romans, Romans chapter 14. If you'll turn there with me in your Bibles. Romans chapter 14, and I'll read the first 13 verses of that chapter. Romans chapter 14, beginning in verse 1. Him that is weak in the faith receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations. For one believeth that he may eat all things, another, who is weak, eateth herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not. And let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth, for God hath received him. Who art thou that judgest another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth, yea, he shall be holden up, for God is able to make him stand. One man esteemeth one day above another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. Him that regardeth the day regardeth it unto the Lord, and he that regardeth not the day, to the Lord he doth not regard it. He that eateth to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks, and he that eateth not to the Lord, he eateth not, and giveth God thanks. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. For whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both of dead and living. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set it not thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, As I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. Let us not therefore judge one another any more, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way.
great message in it. I'm glad he is risen and we are forgiven in Christ when you know him as your personal Savior. If you know Christ your Savior, aren't you glad you're saved? Amen. You always ought to be glad you're saved. Open your Bibles this morning, 2 Samuel, the third chapter, 2 Samuel chapter number 3. As you know, we have been in this study since the first of the year with our theme, which is a heart for God. We are studying the life of David, a man after God's own heart. And we're learning how that can be in our own lives. So we're kind of chronologically, if you would, going through the life of the great man of God named David. And we're learning things about that and then putting them into our lives. I want to give you a little review here before I read the passage to remind you where you're at. This is the 19th message in that series as we continue on through the entire year with that. All right. David is on the throne of the southern kingdom. All right. Saul is dead and those two tribes came to him, and now he is reigning in Hebron. And that is where those tribes are located at in that area, and that's where he reigns from. Saul's family is still on the throne. Ishbosheth, his son, is on the throne of the other tribes. And Abner has been the chief general for Saul for many years. Kind of give you an idea of what's happening. Chapter 3, verse 1 kind of sums it all up. Look at it. There was long war between the house of Saul and the house of David, but David waxed stronger and stronger, and the house of Saul waxed weaker and weaker. That really sums up where we're at, or I'll pick it up in just a moment, but you can understand that. David's is stronger and stronger, Saul weaker, his family weaker and weaker. And you'll see that so evident here. Now, Abner, who was Saul's chief general for many years, had largely remained loyal to Saul and to Saul's family. Matter of fact, Abner is really the strength behind the throne of Saul. Chapter 2, verse 8 tells us that he made Ishbosheth the one, put him as the ruler. So Abner is really the strong man behind that. And you'll see today Ishbosheth, who just got weaker and weaker. All right? Now, pick it up in the passage, because you say, what does it mean to us? Oh, stay with me today. It's going to help all of us. Notice, let me read verse number 6. Chapter 3, look at your Bibles, verse number 6. And Saul had a concubine whose name was Rizpah. Take her name, by the way, Rizpah, put it in your memory bank. We'll see her again in a number of weeks. She'll come back and we'll hear something else about her later in the life of David. The daughter of Aiah. And Ishbosheth said to Abner, wherefore dost thou gone into my father's concubine? Then was Abner very wroth for the words of Ishbosheth, and said, am I a dog's head, which against Judah to show kindness this day unto the house of Saul thy father, and to his brethren, to his friends? And had I delivered thee into the hand of David, thou chargest me today with a fault concerning this woman? So do God to Abner and more also, except as the Lord hath sworn to David, even so I do to him. To translate the kingdom from the house of Saul, to set it up, the throne of David, over Israel and over Judah, from Dan even to Beersheba. And he could not answer Abner a word again, because he, that's Ishbosheth, feared him being Abner. All is about to drastically change in this chapter. And you'll see that in just a little bit. Now, often when we come to these narrative accounts, though, here's what our thought is. And I say this to you each time because I remind you of that God has a purpose for what he records out in his word. He never gives it to us and just said, isn't this interesting stories? I want you to know this. God says, there's something I want you to learn from these accounts. I'm going to ask you just a couple of questions to get us started. I take that back. Not a couple. Let me go to three. You can handle them. Have you ever been frustrated? I see it's pretty much uniformity here. We've all been frustrated. All right? And you know what happens? Circumstances frustrate us. Hey, watch this. People frustrate us. Do you agree? Yeah, you do. Don't look around. Don't even look beside you. You get frustrated about things. You wonder what the next step might be. Question number two. Have you ever been upset at injustice? Yeah. That's not right. That's not fair. Why did that happen? Injustice. Ask you a third question. Have you ever wanted something done,
But you did not have the power to do anything about it. Yeah, that happens to all of us. Well, if I could just get my hands on that situation, I could really mess it up. I mean, really fix it. You know what I'm talking about. We all get that way. This passage I'm going to show you in chapter number 3 helps us. Don't come in today and say, boy, I tell you what, so-and-so, they really need this message. We need this message. Because sometimes we get frustrated. We see injustice. We don't see things the way we want them to be. I have seen in this account, the heart of David is going to help us. We'll just examine it. I just touched on the story. I'll give you the entire story through the message. And don't worry, we'll be done in plenty of time. We'll be done in time for the service at 6. Not a problem. I want you to notice, first of all, in the passage, there is accusation. Begins in verse number 6, and we read it. As noted here, Saul's house is imploding. It is collapsing. That's exactly what is happening. Let me explain this accusation, this passage here, so you understand it. We read it, but I want to make sure you fully grasp it. In verse number 6, Abner was strengthening himself. Basically, here's what happens in verse number 6. Abner is strengthening himself to become the king. He really wants Ishbosheth's place. He put him in chapter number 2, verse 8, but now he's kind of scheming about, and he really wants it. And he is the strong man in that kingdom. So that's really what's happening in verse number 6. Ishbosheth, who is the son of Saul, it was his responsibility to care for these wives and the concubines. And I'm not getting into all that today. I remind you that I talked about last week. If you need to understand that, go listen to the message from last week. God made it always very clear. One man, one woman for life. I said that last week. Got as many amens as I did that time, so let's try one more time. One man, one woman for life. Amen. Good. All right. Make sure you're still with me. Here's what would happen, though. Ishbosheth's responsible to care for all the household of Saul. And a rival would do this. A rival that he understood could take the throne and do whatever he wanted. So Ishbosheth is on the throne. He's very weak. Abner's the strong man. Abner does this. He goes into the household of Saul. You read that in verse number 7. That notice what it says. That he goes in to a lady by the name of Rizpah. He goes and takes one of the concubines of Saul. Everybody understood when he did that, his intention was this. I'm taking the throne. Okay, just so you understand, that's the culture of the day. When he went in and did that, it was public knowledge. And so when he went in to do that, he was infringing on the throne of Saul. But he wasn't trying to infringe. He was going for the whole kingdom. And this is what he's doing. And so notice what happens. He is accused of that. Matter of fact, verse number 7, Ishbosheth says, wherefore hast thou gone to my father's concubine? Verse number 8, Abner's furious. That's the word wroth. Matter of fact, if I'm not mistaken, let me go back and look at it. Yes, he was not just wroth. He was, what's the word before that? Very. It's in your Bibles, folks. Very wroth. Very angry. And he comes at Ishbosheth, and he's furious. I notice this. He's furious, but he's also guilty. Who are you to say these things to me? Who are you the one to do this to me? By the way, that's guilt. He's completely guilty. But he's furious about it. But Ishbosheth is so weak. There's nothing he can do. At this point, Abner in verse 8, 9, and 10 basically says this. I'll tell you what I'm going to do, Ishbosheth. I'm going to help David out. I'll show you. I'm going to the other side. What could Ishbosheth do? Verse 11 tells you that. He couldn't do anything. He was so weak. Matter of fact, look what it says. He feared him. Accusation. Here it comes. Continue on, look at verse number 12. There's not only accusation in the passage, there's defection. Look at verse 12. And Abner sent messengers to David on his behalf, saying, "Whose is the land?" Saying, "Also make thy league with me, and behold, my hand shall be with thee to bring about all Israel to thee." What happens here? Abner is basically making good on what he says to Ishbosheth. "I told you I'll go over to David," so he does that. Verse number 12. He goes to David, and he sends message to him, says, "Make a league with me. And this is what we'll do. I mean, look, I'm coming over to you." Now, look, the whole time David knows about Abner. Matter of fact, if you'll remember, David earlier had called out Abner for not protecting Saul. You remember that time? Yes? Now, did he go back and preach that message again? No. That's the firmest you've been all morning. No, we heard that one. All right. You remember that. Matter of fact, he said, "Abner, it's your responsibility to take care of Saul," and you didn't do it. So David already understands all about Abner. Here's what Abner's seeing here. Abner's understanding this. He knows David is getting stronger and stronger, the house of Saul getting weaker and weaker. Basically, Abner knows this. It's time for me to move to the winning side before something happens to me. He already knows that Ishbosheth, he has like no power left whatsoever. He already knows that Israel is moving toward David, and I'll show you that in just a little bit. He understood this also. Better to be on the winning side than die in battle. I can either go join up with David or he'll kill me in battle. Because David was a great military general and a great military might. And everybody in Israel knew what eventually would come. Just a matter of time, David will be over the throne of all of Israel. Notice in your notes here, the people, they want peace. They want the stability in their nation. Abner here is a wicked and sinful man. Let me just take something right here, because I started the message with it, and I want you to understand this. There is injustice in the world. There are the things that you will not be able to grasp sometimes. There'll be times you'll put your head down on the pillow and you will say in your mind, "Why? Why this? Why that way? How could it happen?" Injustice. It's so true. We've all seen it. We've all lived it. I will also tell you this, though. God can, even in the midst of injustice, use it for His honor and glory. God has no limitations. God always acts in accordance to His word, though. God will never do anything contrary to this book. Never. And here also, God is going to use the very injustice of Abner and deliver the entire throne to David. Now, I'll show you that in just a moment. Because if you'll notice, David does nothing here. Abner comes to him. Continue on. Look at verse number 12. Abner sent messages to David, "Who is the land?" Saying, "Also make thy league with me, and behold, my hand shall be with thee to bring about all Israel to thee." David says something very interesting. I touched on this last week, verse 13. He said, "Well, I will make a league with thee, but one thing I require of thee. Thou shalt not see my face, except thou first bring Michal, Saul's daughter, when thou comest to see my face." David said, "You want to come make a league with me? Here's what you have to do. Michal needs to return to where she needs to be." You remember, David married Michal. She needs to come back. And Abner does that. Verse 14, David sent messengers to Ishbosheth, Saul's son, saying, "Deliver me my wife Michal, which I espoused to thee, 400 foreskins in the Philistines." Verse 15, Ishbosheth sent, took her from her husband, even from Phaltiel, the son of Laish, and her husband went with her along, weeping behind her to bear him. Then said Abner unto him, "Go return," and he returned. Now, I don't have time to cover all this, except I got to stay with the story. David says, "You return Michal, we'll talk." Michal is now sent back to David, and she had been given to someone else in the meantime, and her husband's following behind her. He's crying, he's weeping, and Abner turns around and says, go home. And he goes home. So what does that mean? Just what it says. All right? You picture that in your mind, can't you? Pick it up, though. Verse 17, what Abner does. Abner had communication with the elders of Israel, saying, you sought for David in times past to be king over you. Now, then, do it. For the Lord has spoken of David, saying, by the hand of my servant David, I will save my people Israel out of the hand of the Philistines and out of the hand of all their enemies. Abner now is delivering on what he says. He goes to those tribes of Israel and he says, look, it's time to come under David. You know, he's basically telling them, you know this is eventually going to happen. You know that God is blessing David. You know that he is the one that can protect all of Israel. It's time to do that. I think this also, Abner knew it was their desire to be under Israel, under David, I should say. It was their desire to be following him, because they already knew that David had the attention of all their enemies, that David had brought peace into those two tribes, that David was leading them, and his house was growing stronger and stronger and more mighty all the time. And they knew that David would protect the kingdom. He does something interesting. I'll pick this up, show you in verse number 19. Abner also spake in the ears of Benjamin. Abner went also to speak in the ears of David in Hebron. All this seemed good to Israel, and that seemed good to the whole house of Benjamin. Abner makes a side trip over to the tribe of Benjamin. You know why? Because Saul was out of the tribe of Benjamin. And so he already knew the tribe of Benjamin would have been loyal to the house of Saul. He was one of their own. So David comes to them, Abner does, and makes a special plea. He says, listen, you need to get on board. You need to forget this other stuff and forget Ishbosheth, and you need to come under that. Verse 20, Abner comes to David, to Hebron, and 20 men with him. David made Abner and the men that were with him a feast. And Abner said to David, I will arise and go, and will gather all Israel unto my lord the king, that they may make a league with thee. Thou mayest reign over all that thine heart desireth. And David sent Abner away, and he went in peace. A feast is set up. Final negotiations are made. And basically, here's what happens. The kingdom comes together. All right? Now, pick it up in verse 22. And I want to show you a third thing. There's intervention. What happens now? Behold, the servants of David and Joab came from pursuing a troop and brought in a great spoil with them. But Abner was not with David in Hebron, for he had sent him away, and he was gone in peace. Here's what happens. Intervention. Abner goes to make this, get all the negotiations done, bring all the kingdom together. And as he goes and he's gone, Joab comes back. Y'all remember him, don't you? He's ruthless. He's been out pursuing the enemy. He comes back in and he hears what's going on. He gets filled in. And you know why he's upset? Because David never consulted him about Abner. Pick it up, look at verse number 23. When Joab and all the host who was with him were come, they told Joab, saying, Abner the son of Ner came to the king, and he has sent him away, and he's gone in peace. Joab came to the king, that's to David. Notice what he says. What hast thou done? Behold, Abner came unto thee. Why is it thou sent him away, and he is quite gone? Thou knowest Abner the son of Ner. He came to deceive thee, to know thy going out and thy coming in, and to know all that thou doest. But when Joab was come out from David, he sent messengers after Abner, which brought him again from the well of Sirah. But David knew it not. Stay with me for just a moment. I'm going to pull all this together. Are you still with me? I don't want to start over. Here's what happens. Joab's furious. David, you should have consulted me. You don't understand. Abner is the enemy. He's coming in here to find out how you work, how you operate. That's what he means. You're going in and you're coming out. Because he was deceiving you. So basically he's saying this so that he can kill you. He's the enemy. Joab goes out and sends a message. Sends the messengers on up ahead. He said, find wherever Abner is and ask him to come back. calls him back, if you would, verse 26, for more negotiations. Look at verse 27. And when Abner was turned to Hebron, Joab took him aside in the gate to speak with him quietly and smote him there under the fifth rib that he died. He comes back. Story goes. Joab says, Abner, come over here. I want to talk to you privately about this matter. I want to do some more negotiations. Joab's a military man. Joab's ruthless. He takes matters into his own hands. You read the verse. Easy to understand. Not a problem to interpret it. He kills him. Matter of fact, it tells us specifically where he did it at. That's quite a picture, isn't it? Intervention. Sometimes we're at the point now where we see once again, this isn't right. There's lamentation, though. Drop down to verse 31. David said to Joab and to all the people that were with him, rend your clothes, gird you with sackcloth, and mourn before Abner. And the king himself followed the bier. What is happening there? See, Joab has taken the life of Abner. Joab's whole purpose here is not even to secure the throne. Joab has lived all his life on the revenge factor. If you'll remember the story we've already seen before, Abner had already killed Joab's brother. When Asahel chased him down and Abner killed him, chapter number 2. David sees this event going on and demands all of Israel to lament. Matter of fact, David even goes a step further. He demands the sons of Zariah. Who is that? That's Joab and his brother. He even demands of them that they do this also. And the king is lamenting. Matter of fact, look at verse 33. And the king lamented over Abner and said, died Abner as a fool dieth? Look at verse number 35. And when all the people came to cause David to eat meat while it was yet day, David swears, saying, so do God to me and more also if I taste bread or aught else till the sun be down. I mean, David is literally lamenting the death of Abner. Matter of fact, he composes a poem, which we know David was so good at when we see the Psalms. Publicly, he's lamenting the death of Abner. He demands all the people do it, and he demands that Joab does it. I will say this. I think one of the reasons he's doing it is he wants everybody to know, I don't have any part of that. He knows the kingdom is maybe at the point of teetering back and forth. Matter of fact, you just read the verse. David goes so far as to fast for the rest of the day over the death of Abner. Lamentation. Let me show you something else here. Look at verse 35. Verse 36. And all the people took notice of it, and it pleased them. Notice this. As whatsoever the king did pleased all the people. Isn't that something? David here, watch as I'm wrapping this up. David was in a tough spot with Joab. Why is that? First of all, because Joab had been with David during all those tough years. When David was hiding down in the wilderness of Judea, Joab was always there with him. Also because he understood Joab was a great general. He also knew that Joab had great influence. He also knew that public sentiment would actually be behind Joab. See, he understood all that, especially there in Judah, because those people had already known what had been up with Abner in the past. But I like this. Look at verse 37. For all the people and all Israel understood that day that it was not of the king to slay Abner, the son of Ner. People knew that this murder was not of David. Now, the last point I want to give you, I'm going to pull all together, and that's the word consternation. Consternation. How do you deal with injustice? Stay with me. Look at verse 38 and 39. And the king said unto his servants, know ye not that there is a prince and a great man fallen this day in Israel? And I am this day weak, though anointed king. And these men, the sons of Zariah, be too hard for me. The Lord shall reward the doer of evil according to his wickedness. You want to put something next to this in your Bible, you can put this down right here. There's a man who's after God's own heart. David shows incredible wisdom here. David teaches us things we better learn. Injustice. You come out of here, you go home sometime, come home, your house is robbed. Hey, that's a bad day. Who would do that? Why would they do that? I mean, you say, man, I'm in God's house. And that's what happens. A couple years ago, I was here preaching on Sunday morning, came out and someone smashed my window. Well, that's not fair. Do you think it's fair, Brother Fernandez? I mean, here preaching and someone's out there smashing my window. And then my insurance won't cover it. That's even worse. Where's justice? We've all been there. Not that, it's something else. Look at verse 39. Look at it one more time. The Lord shall reward the doer of evil according to his wickedness. So what in the world, Pastor, does this story have to do with me? I'm so glad you asked. Four final thoughts that's going to help you when you say, why is there injustice? Why is it not fair? Number one, catch us. Remember this. Watch, there is a true God. There's only one. There's only one true living God. He has no rivals. He will never abdicate the throne. He will never turn it over to another person. He will never turn over to any other god. All other gods are dead gods, false gods. There's only one true God. And I want to remind you of this. He misses nothing. I never sleep, he says. I never slumber. I created all things, and he's such a great God. He didn't just take the universe and spin it out there and said, you're on your own, but rather he said, not only am I the creator of the earth, I am the sustainer of the earth. I am omniscient. I am omnipotent. I'm omnipresent. I'm all those things. Hey, listen, there's only one. There's only one true God. Never, ever, ever, ever forget that. Oh, Pastor, I already know that. What does that have to do with injustice? If you'll remember that, it'll help you with a lot of things in life. Solve a lot of your problems. But I'll give you number two for time's sake. God always has a purpose and a plan. God always has a purpose and a plan. Let me read you one of what David says in one of the Psalms, 135. Listen to this one. Boy, I tell you, this is so helpful to me. The 135th Psalm, 6th verse says this, whatsoever the Lord pleased, that did he in heaven and in earth, in the seas, in all deep places. He does it all. He knows exactly how to do it. He always has a purpose. He always has a plan. He employs the good works and the evil deeds of man. Even when man does those evil things, God can take those and he still has a purpose. Is he hurt by those things? Yes. Do they bring consequences upon themselves? Yes. But God is such a marvelous, wonderful, infinite, purposeful God that he can take some of the injustice and turn it into something amazing. Amazing how he does that. A couple weeks ago when we were in the Bahamas and I was preaching on Sunday night. It was Sunday night. Yes, it was. And I shared this with our deacons the other night. That riddle of Samson is incredible. In the book of Judges, you'll remember the riddle that he gave to the Philistines. And part of that first riddle, he says, out of the eater came forth meat. What does he mean by that? Out of something that should have destroyed, that's the eater, came forth food. It should have destroyed the lion, should have destroyed Samson. But instead, he ripped the lion apart, and later when he came back, there was honey in it. Out of the eater, something that should have destroyed, there came forth meat. I'm saying this, there could be some things that come in your life that should have done you in. But out of the eater, something that should have destroyed you, came forth meat. Amazing. Hey, listen, only God can do that. Number three, this is why we need a Savior. Oh, whoa. Give me that one more time. What do you mean this? This is why when we see the injustice, when we see these things that go about us that we don't like, that's the exact reason why the world needs a Savior. Because without a Savior, there's no redemption. Without a Savior, there's no understanding. Without a Savior, there's no heaven for us. God looked down, he sees the injustice, he sees the sinfulness of man. And so he says, that's why he says, I'm sending my son to die for your sins. The sacrifice of Calvary shows us every day why we need a Savior. And when I look around the things in Baltimore, and I look around Maryland, I look around the country. Listen, I even look at Virginia Beach this week. I look around the world. It shows me once again, this is exactly why we need a Savior. You have the heartache in your life. It shows once again, this is why we need a Savior. Christ. He is everything. Everything. Number four. I told you the only four. I'm giving you number four. All of us will give an account. Earlier, Brother Masterson read Romans 14 for us. There's a purpose in that. So then it says we must all give an account. Every individual in this room will give an account of your life before the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the great judge. And you will stand and you will give an account. That's really what David is saying at the end of verse 39. The Lord is on the throne. See, when he says about that God understands that he will take care of the doer of evil. Here's our problem. Let's deal with us. Is that what we want to deal with today? One amen. Thank you. But here's a fact. Sometimes we say, just let me handle it on my own. You handle it on your own, let me make you a promise. You'll make a mess. David looked at the situation around him. He said, God, this one's yours. What's happening is wrong. It's injustice. It's taking matters into their own hands. I will give you this. David does not deal with Joab for years. Before he dies, he tells Solomon, Solomon, you're going on the throne. You better watch Joab. In case you want to know what happens, Solomon removes Joab permanently. You read that. I won't preach on that one. Well, I will, but not in this series. You see, David understood this. Man, look, let God handle some of these things. My purpose, what David is saying here, is just to serve Almighty God, to do exactly what his will is. And listen,
Leave it to Him.
I'll take care of this. I'll do it on my own. Leave it to Him. It's not fair. It's not right. It's not this. You might be right. It might not be fair. It might not be right. It might be injustice. That might be true. Leave it to Him. If not, it will consume you. And your eyes will be off the Lord Jesus Christ and onto that circumstance. And it'll frustrate you. It'll take away your peace. It'll remove your joy. You'll be a miserable person. Don't let it happen. David said, Lord, it's yours. It's yours. Learn that lesson today. Father, thank you for your word today. The entrance of thy word giveth light. I ask now that you will just use the preaching and teaching of your word. We see in our lives so much injustice, so much things that bother us that way. Those things work in our lives to grab our attention and our focus. And I'd ask that our focus would be on Christ and not on events and things and injustice. May we, in the meantime, walk justly and walk according to your word and show forth to this world Christ, the answer to everything. I realize, Father, we will all give an account. There might be some here today who would give that account at that time of the great white throne because they don't know Christ. A tragedy that is today. But it doesn't have to be that way. Today can be the day of salvation. So I ask that you would work there. For those of us who may already be here that know Christ as our personal Savior, I would ask that we would understand that we will give an account at the judgment seat of Christ. And that we would be faithful to you now. So our account may be something glorious to you. Use the preaching of your word. With our heads bowed and eyes closed, in a moment we have our invitation, we'll be finished. Perhaps today you are here and you do not know Christ as your personal Savior. You do not know for sure.